this session, we need to finish up our cross-examination of the doctrine of total depravity. And we first saw the scriptural case for total depravity and the other four points. Then, in our last session, we cross-examined the scriptural case that seems to teach total depravity. And I hope it became evident that actually those verses that are used don't make such an ironclad case as it sounds at first. When you just hear those verses in a stream, you kind of get overwhelmed. Whoa, they must be right. When you look at the verses one by one or in groups that are similar to each other and say, well, what's the context here? What is he really getting at? Is he trying to make that point? I think that even if somebody still believes in total depravity, they have to admit that those verses can be reasonably seen another way, and in my opinion, more reasonably in another way. But then there's another whole way to go, and that's scriptures that deny the claims of total depravity. Which means if these scriptures really do deny total depravity, then an interpretation of that earlier group of scriptures that is different than interpreting them for total depravity must be required, because the scripture can't contradict itself. Oh, I didn't lose you with that strange sentence. Okay, let's look at Deuteronomy chapter 30. Now remember, if total depravity is true in the New Testament, it is in the Old Testament too. It's a human condition since the fall. So it would be just as true in Old Testament times as New. It wasn't the coming of the gospel that made man totally depraved. If he's totally depraved, it was the fall. And therefore Moses, if the doctrine is true, is writing to people, many of whom are totally depraved. Now you might say, but wait, he's talking to Israel. Aren't they God's chosen people? Yep, and most of them were sinners. Most of them were unbelievers. Most Israelites were not of the faithful remnant. He's addressing the whole nation, of which most were rebels against God in much of their lives. Deuteronomy 30, verses 11 through 14, and then verse 19. For this commandment which I command you today, Moses said, is not too difficult for you. Now, I put an asterisk by difficult because that word is translated differently in some places. Some translations say not too mysterious for you, which is really something, a different meaning altogether, it would seem. But the ESV and the New RSV render it too hard for you. New King James renders it mysterious. The Young's literal translation says too wonderful for you. So obviously mysterious or wonderful is a chosen translation by some, and hard or difficult is a chosen for another. The one I read to you is the New American Standard, which is one of the better translations for literalness. It says, this commandment which I command you is not too difficult for you. This is not beyond your ability to obey, nor is it out of reach. Now, if Moses thought that people who are unregenerated can't follow God, can't obey God, can't seek God, then those commandments would certainly be out of reach for them. A person who's totally depraved in the sense that the Calvinist argues it, everything God has commanded is out of reach for the person who can't choose good, who can't, you know, repent or whatever. But that's not what Moses thought. He says, it's not in heaven that you should say, who will go up to heaven for us and get it for us to make us hear it, that we may observe it, nor is it beyond the sea that you should say, who will cross the sea for us to get it for us and to make us hear it, that we may observe it. But the word is very near to you, in your mouth and in your heart, that you may observe it. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse. Choose life in order that you may live, you and your descendants. Now, this is not written to a bunch of saved individuals, except they'd been their parents and they had been saved out of Egypt a generation earlier, but they weren't saved in the sense of they were all lovers of God, all believers. This was just a group of people. Some of them were believers, some of them were not believers, but they were just the Israelites wandering in the wilderness. And he says, I'm giving you some commands here. You can't tell me this is too hard for you. They're not beyond your reach. You can't make lame excuses like saying, well, how can I know God's commands? I can't go up into heaven and bring him down. You can't be like the Gentiles who live far away and say, well, how can we know the commands? We can't cross the ocean to get them from the Israelites. They came to you. God brought them down to you. He didn't give them to some people far away. He gave them to you. They're right in front of you. You have no excuse. Gentiles who would have to cross the ocean to know God's commandments, they might reasonably be excused for not knowing about it and not doing it. If God hadn't brought it from heaven and we had to go up there to get them, well, we'd have some excuse for not knowing because we can't go up there and get them. But those excuses won't work for you. God has made it near you. He's given it, he's put it on your lap. It's not beyond your reach. Certainly what Moses is saying is you are responsible to obey God because that's entirely possible for you to do. And I'm telling you, choose life as if they could. In fact, throughout the scriptures, God is exhorting people, in most cases rebels, to choose to repent, to choose to obey, to choose to turn around. Every time he commands them to choose, if God actually knows that people are totally depraved in the Calvinistic sense, he's really just teasing. He's really just dangling a carrot on a stick, saying, you're never going to get this, but I'm going to offer it to you anyway. I'm going to command you anyway. And I'm going to punish you if you don't. It's like commanding that chair to go and cook breakfast. And if it doesn't do it, you take a hatchet to it and break it in pieces and throw it in the fire because it didn't do what you said. Well, that chair can't do that. Of course, the chair would never feel the axe blade or the fire, but a human would. And for God to do that to human beings is a very strange thing for a sane and merciful God to do. And I can say that without any irreverence because I don't believe for a moment that that's what God does. I don't believe for a moment that the Bible teaches that. God always treats sinners as if they really do have the choice and they'll be held accountable if they don't make the right one. Proverbs 1, 28 through 30. This is wisdom speaking to the rebellious. It says, then they will call on me, but I will not answer. They will seek me diligently, but they will not find me, because they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord. They would have none of my counsel, and they despised my every rebuke. Now, this is an interesting passage, because these are people who actually do seek, in this case, wisdom. But in Proverbs, wisdom means the wisdom of God. In fact, most Christians would assume it's sort of a reference to Christ, is the wisdom of God. Because of 1 Corinthians 1:30, it says Christ has become to us wisdom and sanctification and so forth. But the point here is, wisdom is personified speaking words such as God would speak. In fact, earlier in the passage says, you know, I will pour out my spirit upon you. I'll give you my words and you'll follow me. And this is like things God or Jesus would say, and wisdom is talking. But the time comes where wisdom says, but to the foolish, wisdom says, someday you're going to call on me. Someday you're going to seek me diligently. What? I thought unregenerate people couldn't even want to do that. These are not saved people. These are people God's going to ignore because it's too late. They had their chance. The day of opportunity was there. They didn't seek the Lord while he might be found and call upon him while he is near. So they'll seek him and call upon him when he isn't near and when he can't be found by them because they're too far gone. And they're now under his judgment. Like Pharaoh, once God began to harden his heart. Pharaoh had times earlier in his life he could have repented. He didn't. God hardened his heart. He couldn't repent after that. Couldn't change. But the interesting thing here is that the assumption is that all these people are clearly not the elect. He says, you're going to seek me. You're going to call upon me. You're going to do this diligently. It'll be unavailing, but it's clear that this is not teaching that people who are unregenerate don't have any interest or desire to seek God. Sometimes they do. Sometimes it's too late. Isaiah 7, 15 and 16 talks about Christ. It's the verse right after, you know, unto us a child is born. I'm sorry, not that verse, but the virgin shall conceive and bring forth a son. That verse. It says, curds and honey shall he eat, that he may know to refuse the evil and choose the good. For before the child shall know to refuse the evil and choose the good, the land that you dread will be forsaken by both her kings. Now, here's a reference to a child being born. And we won't get into the difficult parts of the passage. We'll just see what's taken for granted in the passage. A child eventually reaches an age where they can choose the good and refuse the evil. this particular child will not reach that age before some other developments happen. That's the prediction. Within this time frame, a child's very early age, before they know, before they're morally responsible, before they reach an age of accountability, before that time, this event with these kings is going to take place. It's a prophecy about something else, but it takes for granted that everybody knows. When a child is born, there comes a time when they reach the age where they can choose good and refuse evil. It sounds like the choosing of good is not something excluded from people by definition because they're sinners. Of course they're sinners. But they reach an age where they could choose the good if they wished, or not. It doesn't give the slightest impression that choosing the good requires a special regeneration prior to that, or that choosing the evil is inevitable. It makes it sound like it just means reaching the age where you've got enough common sense to make those kinds of choices. Sounds like it's part of human nature to be able to make that kind of a choice. Babies don't know how to do it, but they reach a point where they do. This is not trying to affirm anything except what people already know intuitively. And yet what we know intuitively is that Calvinism is wrong on this point. People can choose good. Now, of course, Calvinists won't deny that some unsaved people choose to do things that are better than other things. For instance, the unsaved man who has the opportunity to seduce his secretary. But he says, no, I'm a married man, I won't do that. And he chooses to be faithful to his wife. That's a good choice. But what the Calvinists will say is that no choice is truly good unless it's done with the motive of glorifying God. No act is truly good unless you do it for the glory of God. And I'm not going to say that's altogether wrong. Any choice that's made that's selfishly motivated it's tainted. It's tainted by sin. But many people choose Christ, choose to repent, partly due to the fact that they are selfishly motivated. It's not the best reason, but it is a reason that some people choose. Even when Christ met Saul on the road to Damascus, he said, it's hard for you to kick against the goads. In other words, you're hurting yourself. Wake up here. Don't you see I'm pricking your heart? Don't you see I've been goading you in a direction and you're fighting it like a cow kicking against the ox goad, against the cattle prod? You're hurting yourself. The cattle prod's trying to get you to go the right way and you're resisting and you just poke yourself, injure yourself. Don't you see that's what you're doing? Wake up. You're hurting yourself here. I mean, there is a sense where, although Paul, as a Pharisee, really did want to please God, but every man has something in him that kind of wants to avoid pain too. And there is such a thing as people making decisions, even that are not altogether selfless, but which are the right decisions that bring them closer to God and eventually even to repent of their sins. As Peter said to the people on the day of Pentecost, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Turn, turn, why will you die, said the Lord. You're going to die if you don't turn. To appeal to people's common sense, for Jesus to say it's better to cut off your hand or your foot or pluck out your eye than to retain that and be thrown into Gehenna. He's obviously saying some choices you can make here are bad for you, but following God, that's good for you. And so God does appeal to people's higher instincts of self-interest, but of course it's better if people make all their decisions just for the glory of God. And that's something Christians need to work at as they grow. Even as Christians, we should be motivated more by an interest in God's glory than what's in it for me. But that doesn't mean that you can't come to Christ at all without having that purest of all motives. Isaiah 56, 4 through 5 says, thus says the Lord to the eunuchs who keep my Sabbaths and choose what pleases me and hold fast my covenant. Even them I will give in my household within my walls a place and a name better than sons and daughters, for I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. Who? The eunuchs who keep my Sabbaths, who choose what pleases God. Do people sometimes choose what doesn't please God? Isn't he kind of meticulously ordaining all choices that are made? I didn't put this in the notes for some reason. It's later in the notes in a different context. But let me show you Isaiah if you've got your Bible there. Isaiah and chapter 66. It says in the in verse 3, it says, "He who kills a bull is as if he slays a man. He who sacrifices a lamb is as if he breaks a dog's neck. He who offers grain offering, it's as if he offered swine's blood. He who burns incense, as if he blesses an idol." Now, what he's saying? He's saying, you Jews, because your heart's so wrong, even though you're offering the right things, it's as if you're offering things that are detestable. This is something that Isaiah says in the very beginning of his book 2 in chapter 1. God, they're offering their sacrifices. They're offering a cow. They're offering the right stuff, their grain. But it, to God, they might as well be offering a human. They might as well be offering a pig. They might as well, you know, a dog. You know, it's unclean, unacceptable. Their sacrifices are the right stuff, but they're unacceptable as if they were the wrong stuff because your heart's wrong. And he says this. He goes on and says, "Just as they have chosen their own ways and their soul delights in their abominations, so I will choose their delusions and bring their fears upon them, because when I called, no one answered. When I spoke, they did not hear. They did evil before my eyes, and they chose that in which I do not delight." Now, God's blaming them for this. He's not saying, yeah, it was inevitable. You're totally depraved. What else can you do? He's saying, you made some choices here. You chose what was wrong, and there, I'm going to make a choice. I'm going to choose how you're judged. You see, God does make choices that we can't change, but he bases them on what our choices already were. Because you chose your own ways, I will choose your consequences. Because you chose what doesn't please me. He's blaming them for that. And he is admitting that he is sovereign. I'm going to choose how this turns out for you. But it's not unconditional. It's because of what you have chosen earlier. So God expects people to make better choices. In your notes again, Ezekiel 33:11, "Say to them, as I live, says the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn from your evil ways. For why should you die, O house of Israel?" Obviously, he's saying, A, you should turn. B, why haven't you done it? Why do you want to die? Well, if God was informed of Augustinian theology, he'd know why they will die, because they have no other choice in the matter. And he's really not a very good economist of his breath, because he wastes a lot of it telling people to repent who can't. And if they can, he doesn't have to tell them, because they're going to inevitably do it anyway. You see, the point here is, if under Calvinism, you can't repent if you're not elect, and you can't not repent if you are elect. So why command someone to repent at all? They're going to inevitably if they're elect, and they're inevitably not going to if they're not. It's really a kind of a strange behavior on God's part if he happens to be convinced of Calvinism. I think he's unconvinced. Acts 17:30, Paul said to the Athenians on Mars Hill, "Truly, these times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all men everywhere to repent." That's a command to repent. Now, the Calvinist doesn't deny that. They say, yeah, there's a general call that goes out to everyone to repent, but it's not the effectual call. It's an outward call. The call to the elect is an inward call. But, of course, we have to ask ourselves, if God has the ability to give an inward call to anyone he wants to, that means those who don't receive it are the ones he doesn't want to receive it. Does he want them to repent, or doesn't he? If he does, why doesn't he give them the inward call? If he doesn't, why does he give them an outward call? Why command people to repent if he doesn't want them to repent? And if he does want them to repent, why not make them do it, since he can do that to anyone he wants to? This is a strange kind of a God that this depicts. It's a God of Greek philosophy. It's not the God that's depicted for us in the Bible. Romans chapter 1, verse 20 and 21 says, "For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but they became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened." Now, this is allegedly a chapter that's talking about a person's original sin and total depravity, but these are people who became darkened. Their hearts were darkened. That's the end of a process of darkening. There, it says they became futile in their thoughts. That means at one time they weren't. These people in their lifetime once knew more than they do. They weren't in the dark. They weren't futile in their thoughts. They made choices to go that way, which means this is not talking about a universal native condition of fallen man. In fact, it's specifically talking, in my opinion, about the Jews who knew the law and rejected it. Now, most people think Romans 1 is about the Gentiles. I won't go into that now. Listen to my lectures on Romans. You'll see why I think it's not about the Jews. That's not the most important point. The important point is, he says, these people clearly had opportunity, real opportunity, to glorify God because they are without excuse for not doing so. Now, I don't care what anyone says. If you require a fish to fly and you punish it because it doesn't do that, unless it's a flying fish, of course, but if it's a goldfish, if you want it to fly, you're asking it to do what it cannot do. You cannot say, you didn't do what I said. You're without excuse. No, the fish can say, I think I have a very good excuse. I don't have wings. It's not my nature to fly. Don't you know what a fish is, dummy? And if God says there's a whole population out here who can't do anything good, they can't choose good, it's not in their nature to do it, it's impossible for them, he says, why aren't you guys doing good? You have no excuse for that. Well, if you have no excuse, then Calvinism must be wrong, because Calvinism gives a very excellent excuse why sinners don't do good. They can't. It's against their nature. Now, we might say anyone with that kind of evil nature should be put down like a rabid dog because they're evil, but you can't say they don't have an excuse. You can't say a rabid dog has no excuse for having rabies. It should just choose not to have rabies. No, it can't do that. You got to put it down. I'm not saying that God can't punish anyone he wants to. He can. He can punish people who've had no real opportunity to do otherwise if he wants. I don't think he does. But he can, because he's God. He's sovereign. But one thing he can't do is say 2 plus 2 equals 5. He can't say, you can't do it, but you have no excuse for not doing it. That's illogical. It's impossible. God cannot lie. God cannot deny himself, and he can't say things that are just not true. This does not support the idea that men are incapable. They are without excuse if they don't. Now, what comes first, regeneration or faith? We saw a couple of verses. One was about Lydia. God opened her heart to heed what Paul said, but that wasn't a verse about this, because this is about people who are unregenerate and sinners, who have no power to worship God, but God does something unilaterally that changes that in them, turns them around, makes them a different kind of person, changes their will. He didn't do anything to change the will of Lydia. Lydia already worshiped God. It was her will to please and glorify God. That was her trajectory. She was already living that way. For him to open her heart to understand the gospel was simply consistent with the fact that God works in believers to will and to do of his good pleasure. This is not saying that that unbelievers, he has to open their hearts in that way. Maybe he does, but that's not a verse about that. It's a verse about something else. Lydia was not an unbeliever. She was a worshiper of God. Also, we talked about 1 John 5:1, whoever believes that Jesus Christ is born of God. We already talked about that. That's not necessarily what it's saying. We can't get into it again. But there are some other verses that we need to talk about. John 1:12-13, which we did see. As many as received him, to them he gave power to become sons of God, even them who believe on his name, which were born of God. And in that passage, it actually says, who were born not of the will of men, nor of the flesh, but of God. Is this saying that these people were born again without willing it? Without the will of man? Well, I've never known anyone who got saved without being willing to be saved, even in Scripture. As a matter of fact, being willing is one of the things that is always a condition. Even Calvinists believe that. They just believe God has to make you willing, and then you can do it. They believe if you're depraved and unregenerate, you can't be willing. But they don't deny that you have to be willing in order to be saved. Of course, God has to make you willing, and then you can be saved. So the will of man is truly involved. No one has ever been saved sans human will. Even Calvinists argue that human will is involved, but God has to give you that will. But it's still, you have to be willing. So John isn't saying that people were born without willing it. He is saying not this, but that. And this is an example of what I sometimes have called a limited negative. And how many of you have heard me talk about limited negatives? The Bible uses a lot of them. It's a figure of speech often found in the Bible, which takes the form of not A, but B, but in fact means not only A, but also B. It's common in Scripture. Jesus said, "Do not think I came to bring peace on the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword." But he really did come to bring peace, did he not? He said, "Peace I give unto you. My peace I leave with you." He's the Prince of Peace. The fruit of the Spirit is peace. Don't Christians receive peace? When he said, "I didn't come to bring peace, but a sword," he means, I didn't come only to bring peace. There's another side of the coin. There's also going to be this sword. Yes, I'll bring peace, but not just that. And this is not unusual in the Bible. Jesus said, "Do not labor for the food that perishes, but labor for the food that endures to eternal life." So I'm not supposed to work for food? Doesn't the Bible say whoever doesn't work shouldn't eat? But Jesus says, "Don't work for the food that perishes." Oh, it's a command. I can't work. Well, he means don't only work for the food that perishes. Make sure you also work for the food that endures to eternal life. This is called a limited negative. It's not an absolute negative. It's not absolutely don't work for the food that perishes. Absolutely don't think I'm going to bring peace in the world. I'm not going to bring peace. Well, that's not absolute. It's limited by this other statement. I'm also bringing a sword. You also need to labor for the food that endures. Jesus said, when you pray, say, "Do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one." Well, God does lead people into temptation. The Spirit of God led Jesus in the wilderness to be tempted, and the Bible says it's inevitable we're going to be tempted if we're led by God. But the prayer is, don't just lead me into temptation, but deliver me from the evil one. I know I'm going to be led into temptation, but don't let that be the end of it. It's not an absolute don't let me be tempted. What kind of a human would I be in the world if I'm not allowed to be tempted? That's not what I'm asking. Don't only allow me to be tempted, but also allow me to be delivered out of it from the evil one. I don't want to lose this battle of temptation. I don't want to be delivered into the hands of the devil and just abandoned there. I want you to bring me through it. It's a limited negative. And there's lots of those, a lot of them in the Bible. This, I believe, is one of them. These people were not born of the flesh or the will of man. They were born of God. Well, no, they were born of the flesh also, certainly, or else they wouldn't exist. You wouldn't be born, if you weren't born of the flesh, you wouldn't be here to be born of God. They were not only born of the flesh and of the will of man. They were also born of God. This is what this expression means. And it's a very common device in Scripture, this limited negative. And this certainly has to be one. Because otherwise, he's saying, these people who've been born again, they've only been born of God. They've never been born of the flesh. Really? How does this work? How does someone who's never been physically born actually get born of God? Maybe these are like aborted babies, maybe. I don't know, but that's not what he's saying. He's talking about Christians who are born, but their birth is not essentially relevant in terms of their physical birth. It's the fact they were born of God that's relevant. He's not eliminating human will from it, because even Calvinists know that you don't get saved unless you will to. That's human will. Even if God inspires it, it's still your will. Who else's is it if you're making the choice? Even God has to make the choice, they say. But this verse is not able to say what they want it to say, which is that human will plays no role in salvation, only God's will. It's to misunderstand a Hebraism. John 3:9 and also verses 14 and 15 says, Nicodemus answered and said to him, "How can these things be?" What things? What had Jesus said to Nicodemus? Anyone remember? You must be born again. You got to be regenerated. You got to be born again. Nicodemus says, "How? How can a man be born again? Can he enter into his mother's womb again and be born?" We know he asked that question. And Jesus answered him, "Here's how. As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life," or eternal life. How can I be born again? Well, it's like when Moses lifted up the serpent. What did they have to do? They had to look at the serpent and they'd be healed. So Jesus can be lifted up, and whoever believes in him will be born again, will have eternal life. You see, you gain eternal life by being born again. Nicodemus said, how can I be born again? He says, this is how. Believe. Whoever believes will be born again. It's a condition. It's not unconditional. Believing comes first. Being born again is the result. This is the opposite of the Calvinist idea, that regeneration comes first. And there's plenty more like that in the scripture. John 6:40, everyone who believes on him may have everlasting life. Believing is first. Having everlasting life is the result. You gain everlasting life when you're regenerated. So if you believe, you'll be regenerated and have eternal life. John 11:25, he that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Believing first, resulting in living, coming to life, having eternal life, being born again, passing from death into life. Okay? John 20:31, these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Now, what's coming first here, the living or the believing? In every case, that you may believe so that you can have life. You believe so that you'll be born again and have eternal life. That's essentially what is taught here in Scripture. Acts 16:31, to the Philippian jailer, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. He didn't say, if God saves you, then you will believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, you need to believe and the result will be you'll be saved. Romans 5:2, through whom, Christ, also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Now, wait a minute. We have access to grace. Grace for us to be saved and regenerated through grace. How do we get there from here? Through faith. What's that? That's believing. We have access by means of faith. We have access to grace. Grace is across the chasm from us, and we have access to it by crossing the bridge that's called faith. We have access by faith to this grace. And therefore, the faith has to be there before the grace is obtained or enjoyed or tapped into or whatever, benefited from. Galatians 3:26, for you are all children of God. Of course, that is born again into God's family, regenerated. You are all children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. Your faith is the means by which you came to be children of God. Ephesians 1:13, in him you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed already in the past, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. Your seal of the Holy Spirit is when you're born again, the Holy Spirit is given to you, and that's the seal of God's ownership on you. So when the Holy Spirit comes, that's when he brings you to life. You're dead in trespasses and sins. He brings you to life when he comes and dwells in you. That's him being sealed. But that happened after you believed. Having believed, you were sealed. The believing is first. The coming of the Holy Spirit into your life is the result. Ephesians 2:8, by grace you have been saved through faith. We've been regenerated and saved through grace, or by grace. How do we get that? Through believing, through faith. There's not a single verse that outright says we obtain faith as a result of being born again. But there's verse after verse after verse after verse throughout the scriptures that we receive eternal life. We're born again. We become God's children. These are all synonyms. We receive the Holy Spirit by believing. Faith is the condition. Colossians 2:11 and 12 is a good one because it says, in him you were also buried with him in baptism, in which you also were raised with him, is this not regeneration, through faith in the working of God. You came from death to life through what means? By believing. So you had to believe while you were dead so that by believing you could come alive. Apparently being dead in trespasses and sins, which is a phrase I left out just because it was extra here. It's in this passage. We were dead in trespasses, but we have now come from death into life through believing. So the regeneration occurred because I believed, not vice versa. And it goes on. You believed raised with him through faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead, and you, being dead in your trespasses and uncircumcision of your flesh, he has made alive together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. Now notice the phrase, having forgiven you, means this is something that happened earlier. He has made you alive from, you were dead in trespasses, but he's made you alive having previously forgiven you. Now, when are you forgiven? When you believe. Isn't justification being forgiven? Isn't justification by faith? So he says, because he has justified you by your faith, clearly, and he's actually said it was through faith in the earlier sentence, but justification is by faith. If he has forgiven you and then makes you alive, then you believed first and then were made alive second. He has made you alive having forgiven you, which is, of course, referring to an earlier point in the sentence, in the experience. 1 Timothy 1:16, it speaks of those who should hereafter believe on him to eternal life. That is, their believing on him will bring them to the state of eternal life, which has got to be regeneration. Now, R.C. Sproul, of course, who's a Calvinist and does not believe what I've just been saying, he said in one of his lectures on tape that I listened to years ago, he said, I transcribed it, he says, I don't see why an Arminian even bothers to preach the gospel. He must have a lot more confidence in the power of the gospel than I have, because I don't believe that the power of the gospel ever will bring repentance to a person who's not born again. In other words, he says, unless a person is born again, the gospel will not have the power to save them. He says, those Arminians must have more faith in the power of the gospel than I do. I agree. I do. I have much more faith in the power of the gospel, apparently, than he does, because he doesn't believe the power of the gospel can save anyone before they're born again. I just think he's scripturally wrong. Romans 1:16 says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. Not everyone who gets regenerated first, not everyone who's elect even. Everyone who believes, that's something they do. You believe, that's your own choice, your own action. The gospel is the power of God to salvation to those who believe, to the Jew first and also for the Greek. 1 Thessalonians 1:5, for our gospel did not come to you in word only, but also in power. The gospel came in power and the Holy Spirit in much assurance. The power of the gospel is not to be trifled with. It's the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes. Romans 10:17. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. That is, by hearing the gospel. You hear the gospel, then you can believe it. He doesn't say faith comes by regeneration. Faith comes by the decree of God, the sovereign working of God. Faith comes by that. No, faith just comes by hearing the word of God. Or it doesn't come at all. Hearing the word of God doesn't guarantee there will be faith, but no one's going to believe the word if they haven't heard it. That's what Paul's saying. How can they call on him whom they've not heard? That's in the same context, same passage. But the point he's making is that faith comes through us hearing the word of God and obviously not rejecting it. And it saves us. It does a supernatural work of regeneration in us. John 8:31-32, Jesus said to those Jews who believed in him, if you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. You're a slave of sin before that, but the truth will make you free. But what do you have to do to get there? You have to first continue in his words and believe in him. That comes before you can be made free from sin. The Calvinist says, no, you're a slave of sin. A slave can't believe. Well, this one can. The one that Jesus is talking to can, because they are slaves until they're set free. So you see, the next verse is, they said, Abraham said, we've never been in bondage. He said, anyone who commits sin is a slave of sin. This is the context where Jesus says, unbelievers are slaves of sin, but they can be set free. How? By unilateral sovereign act of decree of God's regeneration? No, by continuing in Jesus' words and thereby knowing the truth. And that will make you free. There's no suggestion that the unbeliever can't do that, or that that freeing or regeneration has to happen before they can do it. First Peter 1:23. Peter says, you've been born again. That's regeneration. not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. Now, the Calvinist isn't going to deny that. In fact, the Westminster Confession of Faith says that God sovereignly regenerates people through the word of God. And Peter says you're born again through the word of God. It's just that he leaves out the part about the need for regeneration or a sovereign decree of God. He just says you've been born again by the word of God, a seed planted. If there's some mystery behind the scenes, Peter is either not aware of it or doesn't think it's important enough to talk about. He's given the impression that hearing the word of God is what resulted essentially in our being born again. He doesn't give any idea that there was some secret thing going on. Now, his lack of saying so doesn't mean there wasn't. It's just that if there was, it should say so somewhere. It's not the most obvious thing in the Bible, certainly. There's no clear statement in the Bible that says you have to be regenerated before you can believe, but there sound like there's a lot of statements that say you have to believe to be regenerated. In fact, it seems to be the consistent teaching of Scripture. Hebrews 4:2 says, "For indeed the gospel was preached to us as well as to them." Now, them in the context is the Jews in the wilderness who didn't go into the promised land when they should have. But the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. He didn't say the word didn't profit them because they were not elect. The word didn't profit them because God didn't regenerate them when he could have. He says the problem was they didn't mix it with faith. It wasn't mixed with faith in them. They heard the word, but there was no faith response on their part, and so it didn't benefit from them. The word of God is the power of God to salvation. Arminians agree. Salvation is supernatural. People can't save themselves. They need to be saved by God. They need to be regenerated. Where we differ is that Arminians say people can actually do that. People can actually choose to believe. In fact, they're required to, and they'll be held responsible and punished if they don't. The Calvinist says, no, they can't. God has to do all that. The Bible doesn't tell us so anywhere. Not one verse. Except a couple disputed ones about Lydia and about, you know, whoever believes is born of God. Those are definitely ambiguous, and I said that there's a better way of understanding them even in their immediate context. But apart from those, you really don't have verses saying people have to be regenerated. And those verses don't say it either. So we got a ton of verses saying you have to believe to be saved and to be born again and to have life. Not one clear verse on the other side. And yet it's fundamental to Calvinism. This point that cannot be established from Scripture and is, in fact, contradicted by Scripture. Okay, we already talked about this next point. How can one who is dead in trespasses and sins believe and repent? We talked about that in our last lecture. We can gladly pass over that now and get to Roman numeral 5, and we're definitely coming down the finish line here. Does anyone seek God? This is important because we pointed out that in Romans 3, 9 through 12, where Paul quotes those Psalms and that line from Isaiah about the Jews, how they none does good, none follows God, none seeks God. It's very important to the Calvinists to underscore in those verses, there is none that seeks God. Now, what they think Paul is saying is there are none of the unregenerate who seek God. Certainly, Calvinists know that Paul was a seeker of God, and David was a seeker of God, whom he's quoting. And Isaiah was a seeker of God. All those lines about how evil people were written by people who did seek God. David, Isaiah, Paul. Calvinists are not blind. They know very well, of course there are people that seek God. But their argument is only regenerate people seek God. Unregenerate people are described as those who none do good, none seek God. Now, you might notice if you read the passage, there is no word regenerate or unregenerate in Paul's passage, nor any equivalent, or anything that even remotely raises those concepts in his passage. When David said those things, Isaiah said those things, they never indicated, they were just talking about a class of people who were unregenerate, as opposed to themselves who were regenerate. That's not, as far as we know, the theology of David, or of Isaiah, or even Paul. If it is, he doesn't say so. That's an importation. That's eisegesis. What is literally said, if we're going to take it just what it says and not see any hyperbole in it at all, it's just saying there's not a person on the planet who does good. In fact, in Psalm 14, it says, God looks down on the children of men, human beings in general, to see if any do good. There's none. No one's doing good. Okay, he doesn't say except for the regenerate. He does, however, make it clear that he's not speaking absolutely. He's using hyperbole. He says there is another group, the generation of the righteous, but it doesn't say that they're regenerated. They just, as far as we know, they just made different choices. There is nothing in any of these passages that specifically gives any support to a Calvinist doctrine. What it does say, of course, is that, and I believe using hyperbole, people aren't seeking God anymore. People aren't doing good anymore. They should, but they don't. This is bad times we're living in, bad society. There's some few exceptions, but for the most part, you just don't see it anymore, people seeking God. That's what David's saying, and Paul is not saying something else when he quotes David. He's saying the same thing. There are people who seek God. Not all of them are already regenerated. The Bible does not make a distinction when it talks about people who do and people who do not seek God. It never makes the distinction in the context anywhere. This person was regenerated, that's why he sought God. This person was not regenerated, that's why he didn't seek God. But look at this list of scriptures here. Well, actually, there's a quote from Douglas Wilson I would give you. Douglas Wilson, in his Back to Basics, Calvinist, says, if the words in Romans, and he's talking about the words I was just discussing in Romans 3, if the words in Romans 3 mean anything, not one unregenerate person has ever sought God. Not one. Now, I think that's claiming way too much, because the words of Romans 3 certainly mean something. And it's going so too far to say if they mean anything, they mean what I want them to mean. Because what I want them to mean is that no unregenerated person has ever sought God. But they might not mean that because they don't say that. It is possible that they mean something, but they don't mean that. They could mean, in fact, what they say. And they could mean something consistent with Paul's thought processes and what he's arguing. It's possible they mean something, but not what you're saying, Doug Wilson. This is not the only possibility. It's not even the best possibility. It's the only one Calvinists have ever considered, because they've been taught this is a proof text for our point. Can they read Romans without that paradigm in their head? Maybe not. So they think, if it means anything, it means what I'm saying. That means I can't think of anything else it could possibly mean, which means you don't have much imagination. You haven't really thought critically about it very much, have you? You're just saying so. You're saying, I've never heard a meaning or cannot even think of a meaning except the Calvinist meaning. I think, well, you have a very limited range of thinking on this, because I can think of at least a couple other possible meanings that aren't Calvinist. But really, to say that it means no unregenerate person has ever sought God, and to insert, as he does, the word unregenerate, is to suggest that the passage says something about unregenerate people, which it doesn't mention. How can you say, if this means anything, it means something it doesn't say? Maybe it means what it does say and not what it doesn't say. And this is, a little upsetting me when I'm debating with the Calvinists and they make statements like that. Come on, let's get real. The Calvinist paradigm is not the only paradigm you can superimpose on the scriptures. The grid. You read it through a Calvinist grid and you can only see the Calvinist way. That's not the only way that's there. Deuteronomy 4:29 says, if you shall seek the Lord your God, you shall find him if you seek him with all your heart. Who's he talking to? Any Jew? Israel? Are they all regenerate? Certainly not. Some were, some were not, perhaps. I don't think they're regenerate, but they were not all believers. Some were of the believing remnant, and some were not. That's always been the case in Israel, from the days of Moses. Actually, from the days of Abraham, as Paul points out in Romans 9, which we'll get to sometime here. That'll be fun, Romans 9. Anyway, if you seek him, he will be found by you, 2 Chronicles 15:2 says. Jeremiah 29:13, you shall seek me and find me when you shall search for me with all your heart. Hebrews 11:6, God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. 2 Chronicles 15:4, when they did turn unto the Lord, they sought him, and he was found of them. 2 Chronicles 15:15, all Judah sought him with their whole desire, and he was found of them. 2 Chronicles 19:3, spoken to a person, you have prepared your heart to seek God. Oh, a person prepared his own heart to seek God? I thought only God could do that. 2 Chronicles 34:3, he began to seek after the God of David, his father. And Psalm 34:4, I sought the Lord and he heard me. Now, of course, the Calvinists are going to say about all these cases, well, yeah, the regenerate do that. Yeah, but there's nothing in any of these passages that distinguish between a regenerate and an unregenerate. It just tells us that there are people who seek God, just like there are people who don't seek God. Certainly, you can't insert the word regenerate in any of these passages without eisegesis. And you can't insert the word unregenerate in Romans 3, where there's none that seeks after God, without eisegesis. We can't force the passage to mean something just because we have a theological paradigm to support. Now, Acts 17, 11 through 12 says, these, the Bereans, when they heard the gospel from Paul, they were more fair-minded than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness, and they searched the scriptures daily to find out whether these things were so. Therefore, many of them believed. They certainly weren't saved before they believed, but what led to their believing? Well, they searched the scriptures. Were they seeking God? Sounds like it. Why did they search the scriptures when others didn't? The Thessalonians didn't. Why did the Bereans? Because they were better in their hearts. They were noble-minded. They're more noble-minded than the Thessalonians. When the Calvinist says, you can't say there was something better in you that made you get saved than was in that person who didn't get saved. Well, Luke can say it. Luke can say the Thessalonians, they weren't noble-minded. The Bereans, they were. And they were before they believed. They were before they were Christians. To say that that every unregenerate person is a hater of God simply doesn't fit the facts. These people weren't yet believers in Christ, but they were noble-minded, and they searched the scriptures and believed. Acts 10, verses 1 through 4 is even better. There was a certain man of Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion, a Gentile, of what was called the Italian regiment, a devout man. Now, he didn't know about Jesus yet. He was not regenerated, but he was already a devout man, one who feared God with all his household, who gave alms generously to the people and prayed to God always. Now, is this just a surface hypocritical religion that doesn't please God? No. About the ninth hour of the day, he saw clearly in a vision an angel of God coming and saying to him, Cornelius, your prayers and your alms have come up for a memorial before God. Here's a non-Christian man worshiping God in his ignorance, unregenerate, and what happens? God says, I like what you're doing. You're a pious man. You're a God-fearing man. I'm going to send a preacher to you so you can become a Christian man. This is not a man who's regenerated, but he's not totally depraved. He's not incapable of seeking God. Now, of course, what a Calvinist would say, well, regeneration may be a process, not an instant. God was beginning to regenerate him, which led to him being pious and so forth. I don't know of any place in the Bible that talks about regeneration as a process. It's a birth. It's a passing from death and life. It could be a process. The Bible never says so. But the Bible does say that no one comes to Christ unless the Father draws him. Calvinists like that verse, and so do I. This man, no doubt, was being drawn by God to Christ, but he hadn't gotten there yet, and he was not unutterably wicked. He was a good guy. And the Bible doesn't have any problems saying so. The biblical writers weren't Calvinists. They weren't beholden to a doctrine of total depravity. So they can artlessly and quite innocently say, he was a good man. He wasn't a Christian, but he was a good man. You see, our Orthodox says, we can't say there's any good men. Remember that Rabbi Kirshner who wrote Why Bad Things Happen to Good People, his best-selling book back in the 80s. He was not a Christian. He was a Jew. And he's trying to explain from the book of Job why bad things happen to good people. Well, many Christians from the other title said, there's a good reason. I can answer that. There are no good people. Bad things don't happen to good people because there are no good people. These were dutiful Calvinists saying, there's no one good, no, not one. But is that what the Bible says? Wasn't Cornelius a good man? Certainly not good enough to be saved by his own works. No one is good enough to be saved by their works. It's not, you know, we're not going to the polar opposite of Calvinism. Which Calvin says, nothing they do is good, can't be good. and we're not arguing the opposite. Everything people do is good, and everyone's okay with God. No, there's a mixture. People are fallen. They're damaged. But the thing that's damaged is something made in the image of God. And that has not been totally obliterated. The image of God has been marred, but not obliterated. There's still something of a heart toward God in many people who are not yet, haven't found him. And to say otherwise is simply to say something that's jargon that's set in loyalty to a theological system. It doesn't agree with the Bible. Isaiah 55:6 says, "Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he's near." I gave you this verse earlier. What I said is, it sounds like he's saying there's a time when seeking God will avail and a time when it won't. You better do it now while it will work. But if you're not elect, there will never be a time when you can seek the Lord. And if you are elect, any time will do, because you're going to find him anyway. It's been determined. This sounds like it's saying there's opportunities that people have to seek God. They might miss those opportunities, in which case it might not be good for them. They might, in fact, not have another opportunity like this. But it sounds like they are given an opportunity that isn't always there. And it doesn't sound like the seeking of God is left to God making it happen in them. He's given them a chance right now. It sounds like there's an opportunity here. Take it or leave it. 2 Chronicles 11:16. After the Levites left, those from whom all the tribes of Israel, such as set their hearts to seek the Lord. I didn't read that right, but it says, those people who set their hearts to seek the Lord God of Israel, they came to Jerusalem. They set their hearts. Calvin says, no, only God can change your heart to make you seek him. Well, they did something. They prepared their hearts. They set their hearts to seek God. 2 Chronicles 12:14, and Rehoboam did evil because he did not prepare his heart to seek the Lord. Okay. Some do, some don't. 2 Chronicles 15:12. Then they entered into a covenant to seek the Lord their God with all their fathers, as the God of their fathers with all their hearts. 2 Chronicles 20:3. Jehoshaphat feared and set himself to seek the Lord and proclaimed a fast throughout all Judah. Hosea 10:12. Break up your fallow ground, for it's time to seek the Lord till he comes and rains righteousness on you. You seek first, and then he comes and rains his grace on you. It's time. Break up your hard-hearted ground. You see, all these statements make it clear that people can and are told to seek God. Not one of these passages ever mentions that the people spoken to are or are not regenerated. In my opinion, in the Old Testament, no one was. Calvinists think they were because they have to acknowledge that some people did seek the Lord, and their view is no one can do that unless they're regenerated. So they take the doctrine of regeneration back to the Old Testament too, which is, of course, necessary for them to do. But it's not in the Scripture. It doesn't say that. It's a necessity of their system. Now, just one more point, and we're done with this subject. Why does God have to harden people's hearts or blind sinners if they're already blind and dead, every last one of them to a man? In John 12:40, it says of the Jews, God has blinded their eyes and hardened their hearts, lest they should see with their eyes, lest they should understand with their hearts and turn, so that I should heal them. Now, these are people who are under God's judicial blinding. They were under God's judgment, just like Pharaoh was when God hardened his heart. This is a generation that had rejected Christ, rejected God, and he blinded them as a judgment. That's what Paul says in Romans chapter 11. The elect of Israel have come into righteousness, but the rest were blinded. There's Jesus, when he was asked by his disciples, why do you speak to the people in parables? Implying that the people don't really understand these parables, why do you use them? He said, because to you it is given to know the secrets of the kingdom of heaven. To them it is not given. That seeing they may see and not perceive, hearing they may hear and not understand, lest they should turn and be healed. Quoting the same verse from Isaiah 6 that John here is quoting. Jesus makes it very clear that Israel in his day was under judicial judgment. There was a faithful remnant that already were serving God when he arrived, and God sent them over to him, and they became disciples. The rest were obstinate apostate Israel, and they were under God's judgment, soon to be destroyed by the Romans. But they were like Pharaoh. Before God actually snuffed him, he hardened his heart so that he'd go through some judgment process before he actually died. This generation went through a judgment process too, before the Romans came and wiped them out. That process began with God blinding them so they wouldn't repent, the ones who were already rebellious. But why would he have to do that? It makes it sound like he's afraid they might repent if he doesn't proactively blind them. I thought they couldn't. If God doesn't want someone to repent in Calvinism, all he has to do is exactly nothing. Because if he doesn't make them repent, they can't anyway. If he wants to keep them from repenting, why does he proactively do something to make them not repent? That's a hard question, I think, for Calvinists to answer. Romans 9:18 says, therefore he has mercy on whom he wills, and whom he wills he hardens. Calvinists think that everyone who is unregenerate is in the hardened category, but the Bible doesn't say that. A few people in the Bible, it said that God hardened them, and Paul's specifically thinking of Pharaoh, which is one of the unusual cases. But why does he have to harden Pharaoh? If Pharaoh couldn't make the right decision, couldn't repent without being without being regenerated, couldn't God just withhold regeneration and do nothing at all? Why does he frequently blind people, harden people, when in fact the Calvinist says they're all in that condition already? Then what's left for God to do to blind or harden them? Obviously, the Bible indicates that God blinds some people who were not otherwise blind. He hardens some people who were not otherwise hardened. And he does so that they won't repent, which they might otherwise have done. To my mind, there's no reasonable answer from the Augustinian paradigm to explain why God would have to do such a thing. If Calvinism is true, he wouldn't have to harden anyone or blind anyone. That's the condition everybody's in unless he makes them otherwise. So again, the wording of Scripture again and again and again does not talk as if any scriptural writers were Calvinists. Even the verses that kind of sound like they are, really, you look at them in context and they don't sound so much like they are. But there's a ton of scriptures that sound very much like they're not. We're done with this lecture. We're done with the total depravity.